بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. I mentioned yesterday that there was the story that I still wanted to discuss. It's a very beautiful story with lots of lessons for us to learn from within, continuing from in Surah Tawbah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about the expedition of Tabuk and those that responded wholeheartedly, those that were hesitant then accepted, and then he speaks about the munafiqun, those that provided excuses, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then disclosed their reality to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then speaks about three particular individuals who didn't partake in the Battle of Tabuk, but they were not from the hypocrites. They were true believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. Allah speaking about forgiveness, لَكَدْ تَابَ اللَّهُ وَلَى النَّبِيِّينَ وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has pardoned those three that remain behind. حَتَّى إِذَا ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ وَظَنُّوا أَن لَا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. To the point that the earth became constraint upon them, despite its vastness, and their own selves became constraint upon themselves. And they began to think that لَا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. There is no place to flee from Allah except to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ تَابَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُوا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about pardoning them. Now, as I mentioned, the story itself is very, very interesting and lots of lessons to learn from. And Sayyiduna Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala an, who is the narrator of the hadith, is one of the three that's being referred to here in the Holy Quran. This hadith is mentioned by Imam Bukhari rahimahullah in his Sahih. It's quite a lengthy hadith, so we'll skim through the relevant parts, inshallah. Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he relates that لم أتخلف عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة غزاها إلا في غزوة تبوك غير أني كنت تخلفت في غزوة بدر ولم يعاتب أحد تخلف عنها إنما خرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يريد عير قريش حتى جمع الله بينه وبين عدوهم على غير ميعاد. Ka'b radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that I never missed any expedition that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam commanded, except for the expedition of Tabuk, the Battle of Tabuk. I gave an introduction to the Battle of Tabuk yesterday, how far it was in the it was a very difficult battle in terms of preparation. Fighting really didn't take place, but that's a different story. Except, غَيْرَ أَنِّي تَخَلَّفْتُ فِي غَزْوَةِ بَدْرِ. I didn't partake in the Battle of Badr. However, there was no repercussions for anybody who didn't partake in the Battle of Badr. Why? The Prophet ﷺ didn't leave to take place to partake in a battle. The Prophet ﷺ and a group of companions went to retrieve their caravan without having an understanding of a battle taking place. So missing that wasn't missing a battle. However, he said, the one battle that I did miss and the one expedition that I did not partake in was the expedition of Tabuk. وَلَقَدْ شَهِدْتُ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَيْلَةَ الْعَقَبَةِ حِينَ تَوَاثَقْنَا عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ. I also was with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam the day the pledge of allegiance at Aqaba took place. حَتَّى تُوَاثَقْنَا عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ, where we confirmed our responsibility to Islam. وَمَا أَحَبَّ أَنَّ لِي بِهَا مَشْهَدَ بَدْرٍ. And the reality is that I wouldn't trade Laylatul Aqaba for the Battle of Badr because of how important Laylatul Aqaba was. وَإِنْ كَانَتْ بَدْرَ أَذْكَرَ فِي النَّاسِ مِنْهَا. Even though Badr is more common on the people's tongue. خَيْرٍ كَانَ مِنْ خَبْرِي. So this is his story. أَنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ قَدْتُ أَقْوَى وَلَا أَيْسَرٍ حين تخلفت عنه في تلك الغزوة وفي تلك الغزات. that there wasn't a time in my life where I was more healthy or wealthy than when Ghazwa Tabuk took place. So when the Prophet ﷺ calls the companions and summons them to leave for this battle, he says, I was very well off, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had, in terms of my provisions. I was never in a better place. Doesn't mean he was extremely wealthy, but I was never in a better place in terms of what Allah had bestowed upon me, and I was very healthy. Wallahi majtama'at indi qablahu rahilatani qat hatta jama'atuhuma fi tilka al-ghazat. Before this occasion, I never possessed two mounts. And it just so happened that when the call for this expedition took place, I was in possession of two camels, two she-camels. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يُرِيدُ غَزْوَةً إِلَّا وَرَّى بِغَيْرِهَا حَتَّى كَانَتْ تِلْكَ الْغَزْوَةُ غَزَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي حَرٍّ شَدِيدٍ وَاسْتَقْبَلَ سَفَرًا بَعِيدًا وَمَفَازًا وَعَدُوًّا كَثِيرًا فَجَلَّ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ أَمْرَهُمْ. That prior to this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he was thinking of leading an expedition, he wouldn't tell everybody. From the strategy of the Prophet ﷺ, so that this information isn't leaked in case there was a munafiq, a hypocrite amongst the crowd, that they then pass this message on. So on most occasions where the Prophet ﷺ was preparing for or intending to lead an expedition, he wouldn't tell everybody. Close confidants would know. However, because this expedition involved a very lengthy journey, safaran ba'idan, harrin shadid, and it was extremely hot, and we were going through jungles and forests, وَعَدُوًا كَثِيرًا, and there was a tremendous army that we were told we were going to face. The Prophet ﷺ, for this reason, جَلَّ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ أَمْرَهُمْ. He told everybody right from the onset that we are preparing to leave for Tabuk. And one of the reasons for this was, لِأَتَأَهَّبُوا أَهَبَةَ غَزْوِهِمْ فَأَخْبَرَهُمْ بِوَجْهِهِ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ. So that Allah's Messenger gave them time to prepare for such an expedition. It wasn't something that was a few miles away. As I mentioned yesterday, close to 600 miles or kilometers away from Madinah al-Munawwara. And this is going to be done by foot and by mount. In this extreme heat, in the desert heat. وَالْمُسْلِمُونَ مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَثِيرٌ. And there were lots of Muslims who responded to this call. وَلَا يَجْمَعُهُمْ كِتَابُ حَافِظٍ يُرِيدُ الدِّيوَانِ. And the truth was, their names weren't being recorded anywhere. So there wasn't a book that was collecting the names of everybody that was signing up. فَمَا رَجُلٌ يُرِيدُ أَن يَتَغَيَّبَ إِلَّا ظَنَّ أَنَّهُ سَيَخْفِيَ لَهُ مَا لَمْ يَنزِلْ فِيهِ وَحْيُ اللَّهِ. So if someone intended to stay back, they thought that unless Allah informs the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ won't know. Right? Yeah, because the Prophet ﷺ is not writing these names on his day. He's made an announcement and people are preparing. He says, I had every intention. وَغَزَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى تِلْكَ الْغَزْوَى حِينَ طَابَتِ الثِّمَارُ وَالظِّلَالُ. So he's mentioning the atmosphere, the conditions. That it's when the fruits had ripened. It was extremely hot. وَتَجَهَّزَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَالْمُسْلِمُونَ مَعَهُ. The Muslims and the Prophet ﷺ began to prepare for this. فَتَفِقْتُ أَغْدُ لِكَيْ أَتَجَهَّزَ مَعَهُمْ فَأَرْجِعُ وَلَمْ أَقْضِ شَيْئًا فَأَكُولُ فِي نَفْسِي وَأَنَا قَادِرٌ عَلَيْهِ. That I would leave in the morning like the believers to prepare, but I would get caught up. And I would say to myself, by the end of the day, when nothing had been accomplished, I would say to myself, it's okay, I'll be able to catch up with them. I'll be able to make up the time that I've missed later. So the Muslims, the rest of the camp isn't stopping for anybody, they're continuing. They're making their preparations. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يَتَمَادَى بِي حَتَّى اشْتَدَّ بِالنَّاسِ الْجَدِ. This continued until the Muslims had, the rest of the camp were fully prepared, and time just passed by me. Time passed by me, and everybody else was fully prepared. فَأَصْبَحَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَالْمُسْلِمُونَ مَعَهُ وَلَمْ أَقْضِي مِنْ جَهَازِي شَيْئًا. It just so happened now, the condition was that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Muslims, had completed their preparation. They're beginning to leave. And I've done nothing as of yet. Because I kept delaying, I kept telling myself, I'll catch up, I'll catch up, I'll catch up. فَقُلْتُ أَتَجَهَّزُ بَعْدَهُ بِيَوْمٍ أَوْ يَوْمَيْنِ ثُمَّ الْحَقَهُمْ. So I said to myself, fine, don't worry, I'm young. Let them go forward. I'll do my preparation, I'll catch up with them. فَغَدَوْتُ بَعْدَ فَصَلُّوا لِأَتَجَهَّزَ فَرَجَعْتُ وَلَمْ أَقْضِ شَيْئًا. He says, in the mornings, I would wake up, this is after the camp has left, and I would say, pray, perform my salah. I said, okay, after a little while, I'll do it. And like this, the day would go by. فَرَجَعْتُ وَلَمْ أَقْضِ شَيْئًا ثُمَّ غَدَوْتُ فَرَجَعْتُ وَلَمْ أَقْضِ شَيْئًا. The next day, I'd do the same thing. Just delaying, postponing everything. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ بِي حَتَّى أَسْرَعُ. This continued until they were uncatchable. And he then mentions that the battle takes place and the news starts to come back that they're returning. وَلَيْتَنِي فَعَلْتُ. He says, وَهَمَمْتُ أَنْ أَرْتَحِلَ فَأَدَرِكَهُمْ وَلَيْتَنِي فَعَلْتُ. Even at that point, I thought to myself, let me leave here and meet up with them in the path. At least I've made some effort. And then he said, if only I had done so. وَلَيْتَنِي فَعَلْتُ. فَلَمْ يَقْدِرْ لِي ذَلِكَ وَفَلَمْ يَقْدِرْ لِي ذَلِكَ فَكُنْتُ إِذَا خَرَجْتُ فِي النَّاسِ بَعْدَ خُرُوجِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَتُفْتُ فِيهِمْ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ فَتُفْتُ فِيهِمْ أَحْزَنَنِي أَنِّي لَا أَرَى إِلَّا رَجُلًا مَغْمُوسًا عَلَيْهِ النِّفَاقُ أَوْ رَجُلًا مِمَّنْ عَذَرَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الضَّعْفَاءِ. He said, after this happened, they had left. I realized I wasn't going to catch up with them. They're on their way back. I would leave for the market in the morning. And he said, what disappointed me was I would only see those faces whom Allah had excused from battle or who were clear hypocrites, and we knew that they were munafiqs. I was stuck in this conundrum that I am now amongst those who are not expected to battle because they are ma'adhoor, elderly, ill, looking after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who gave permission to look after the household if nobody else was there, or the open hypocrites or the munafiqs that we knew. Now before we go any further, this mistake of Ka'b radiallahu ta'ala, it has tremendous ramifications. We're going to get to them in a bit. It's all the result of putting off a good deed for later. Putting off good that I will do it later. And it's a mistake that we all continuously make. Allah says in the Holy Quran, سَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. Hasten towards the forgiveness of your Lord. Don't delay. Good deeds, the moment it comes into your mind that this is an opportunity of a good deed, understand that that notion of delaying it is from the deception of shaitan. Shaitan very rarely is going to make someone who's inclined towards religion think that, no, you know, sadaqah, that's such a bad thing, I'm not going to do it. No believer is going to think like that. So when the opportunity of sadaqah comes in front of a person, shaitan's a very clever enemy. He's not going to say to the person, sadaqah is a bad thing, so don't do it. Because the believer wouldn't follow that. The believer, someone who has any love of Allah, will know sadaqah is good. So even if shaitan's to whisper that sadaqah, na'udhu billah, is a bad thing, the person's going to think, no, of course, sadaqah is good. But this clever enemy, he doesn't take away the notion of that good, of that worship being good and turning into bad. It stops the person from doing it somehow. And what's the easiest way? To convince the person that he will do it, but just don't do it now. It's the easiest way. For shaitan to whisper into our ears that, yeah, of course, salah, I'm going to read. Still, football's on, there's still an hour and a half left. Sadaqah is there. Yeah, of course, I'm going to have to give sadaqah. But I'm going to buy lunch. I don't want to spend this right now. I'll give sadaqah later. And this is the ploy of shaitan, that he prods you to put off good deeds. How many a times has it been that we've said to ourselves, we're very adamant, inshallah we're going to do this, but we actually forget about that afterwards, and it's a good deed. And we've told ourselves, I'm going to do it, but I just not now. And it just so happens that that time to do that good deed then expires. How many a times has that happened to us? How many a times? And so Allah is telling us that the moment the intention of a good deed enters your heart, run towards it, do it. Become habitual of fulfilling that good deed as soon as it enters into the mind. It's the easiest way to combat shaitan. And we will have these moments throughout the day where an opportunity for good arises, but we will tell ourselves, I will do that later on. But 9 times out of 10, that later on doesn't come. The shaitan is not going to remind you to do it afterwards. He wants you to forget. وَلَمْ يَذْكُرْنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ حَتَّى بَلَغَ تَبُوقًا. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ka'b radiallahu ta'ala says, that the Messenger ﷺ did not remember me until he reached Tabuk. فَقَالْ. He then said, وَهُوَ جَالِسٌ فِي الْقَوْمِ بِتَبُوكْ. Whilst he was with the people in Tabuk, seated, مَا فَعَلَ قَعْب. What's happened to Ka'b? فَقَالَ رَجُلٌ مِّن بَنِي سَلَمَة. An individual from Banu Salama said, Ya Rasulullah, حَبَسَهُ بُرَادَهُ وَنَذَرُهُ فِي عَطِفَيْهِ. That his cloaks have prevented him from coming and is looking to his two flanks, meaning pride. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. فَقَالَ مُعَاذُ بْنُ جَبَلْ رضي الله تعالى said, بِئْسَ مَا قُلْتْ. Very bad what you've said. وَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ O Messenger of Allah, مَا عَلِمْنَا عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا خَيْرًا. We only know good of Ka'b رضي الله تعالى. فَسَكَتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet stayed quiet, didn't respond. قَالَ كَعْبِ بْنُ مَالِكْ. Ka'b رضي الله تعالى then says, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَنِي أَنَّهُ تَوَجَّهَ قَافِلًا. When I received the news that the Prophet is now nearing Madinah al-Munawwara, هَذَرَنِي himmi wa tafiqtu atadhakkaru al-kadhib or kidhb, that I thought to myself, okay, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming now, I've got to present an excuse. And so I started conjuring false excuses in my mind, that I'll say, this is the reason I couldn't come, this is the reason why I couldn't come. Wa aqulu bimadha akhraju min sakhati ghadan. I said to myself, how can I remove this anger from the Messenger? He's going to be angry that I didn't come. وَاسْتَعَنْتُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ بِكُلِّ ذِي رَأِيٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِي. And I began to ask everyone from my family. أَمَّا بَعَدْ. فَلَمَّا قِيلْ. When it was said, إِنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَدْ أَظَلَّ قَادِمًا زَاحَ عَنِّي الْبَاطِلَ وَأَرَفْتُ أَنِّي لَنْ أَخْرُجَ مِنْهُ أَبَدًا بِشَيْءٍ فِيهِ كذب فأجمعت صدقه. When it was said to me that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is upon us and he is here, and I realized at that moment that I can't lie. No lie of mine is going to get me through this situation. وأصبح رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قادما. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came in the morning. وَكَانَ إِذَا قَدِيمَ مِنْ سَفَرٍ بَدَأَ بِالْمَسْجِدِ فَيَرْقَعُ فِي رَكَعَتَيْنِ. As was his practice, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to the masjid, offered 2 rak'ats. ثُمَّ جَلَسَ لِلنَّاسِ. Then he sat for the people. فَلَمَّا فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ جَاءَهُ الْمُخَلَّفُونَ. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat for the people who had stayed behind, they started coming in their groups. And they began to present their excuses. فَتَفِقُوا يَعْتَذِرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this, يَعْتَذِرُونَ إِلَيْكُمْ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ, what we discussed yesterday. So they began giving their excuse, and the Prophet said, fine, because Allah said, فَعَرِضُ عَنْهُمْ, okay, accept it from them. فَقَبِلَ مِنْهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَانِيَتُهُمْ وَبَايَعَهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمْ وَكُلُّ سَرَائِرِهِمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ. The Prophet the secret was between them and Allah, and Allah knows who was honest and who wasn't honest. فجئت أمشي حتى جلست بين يدي. Ka'b says, then I came and I sat in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فقال لي ما خلفك ألم تكن قد ابتعت ظهرك. He said, come, what prevented you from joining us? Is it not true that you had purchased your mount as well? Meaning you'd made the preparations in terms of you had your mount, you just needed to do everything else and make the journey with us. فَقُلْتُ بَلَى. Ka'ab said, yes, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنِّي وَاللَّهِ. Then he says, I swear by Allah, لَوْ جَلَسْتُ عِنْدَ غَيْرِكَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الدُّنْيَا. If I was sat in front of anybody else, لَرَأَيْتُ أَنْ سَأَخْرُجَ مِنْ سَخَتِهِ بِعُذْرٍ وَلَقَدْ عُؤْتِيتُ جَدَلًا. Then if anybody else was sat in front of me, Ya Rasulullah, then Allah has given me the gift of the gab, and I would have worded my way out of this situation, and I would have squirmed away from that person's anger. وَلَكِنِّي وَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ لَإِنْ حَدَّثْتُكَ الْيَوْمَ حَدِيثَ كَذِبٍ تَرْضَى بِهِ عَنِّي لَيُشِكَنَّ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَسْخَطَكَ عَلَيَّ. But I've realized that even if I say something that pleases you now, Allah will make you and cause you to be displeased with me later. وَلَإِنْ حَدَّثْتُكَ حَدِيثَ صِدْقٍ تَجِدُ عَلَيَّ فِيهِ إِنِّي لَأَرْجُ فِيهِ عَفُوَ اللَّهِ. And if I tell you the truth and you become upset with me, then I have hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will still turn that in my favor after. لَا وَاللَّهِ مَا كَانَ لِي مِنْ عُذْرٍ. I swear by Allah, I have no excuse. وَاللَّهِ مَا كُنْتُ قَدْتُ أَقْوَى وَلَا أَيْسَرَ مِنِّي حِينَ تَخَلَّفْتُ عَنْكَ. And by Allah, I was never more in a position to join you in terms of wealth and in terms of my physical strength. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ said, أَمَّا هَذَا فَقَدْ صَدَقَ. As for this, he was referring to the others that had come. أَمَّا هَذَا, as for this person, then he has spoken the truth. فَقُمْ. But now, the ramifications. فَقُمْ. Stand up. حَتَّى يَقْضِي اللَّهُ فِيكَ. And it's Allah that will make the judgment for you. Why? You've disobeyed a direct command of mine. Nafiru Aam. Everybody was commanded to join this expedition. No excuses. Unless someone came to me. Fakumtu. I stood up. And he said, some of my family members came behind me and said, what is wrong with you, Ka'ab? What is wrong with you? Look at how many people before you came and gave excuses. Just make an excuse up. And then afterwards, go back to the Prophet ﷺ, ask him to seek repentance on your behalf that you lied about the mistake. Allah will forgive you. So go, look at how many people, 80 plus 80 munafiqs. They all came and gave their excuses. So yes, lie a little bit. But then afterwards, tell the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, I made a mistake. Please ask Allah for my forgiveness. And Allah will forgive you if the Prophet asks. So he said, they continued to pressure me until I thought, okay, should I go back? Should I return to the Prophet? Then I said, wait. Is there anyone else that's in a similar position to mine, who's presented no excuses and said they stayed behind? They said, yes. Two people. فَقُلْتُ مَنْ هُمَا. So I said, who are they? قالوا مرارة ابن ربيع وهلال ابن أمية. Two individuals, مرارة ابن ربيع and هلال ابن أمية رضي الله تعالى عنهما. And so I said to myself, these are pious people. These are people that are godly. And if they have stuck to the truth, they are people that I should follow as well. So no, I'm not going to go back. And he said, I'll leave it at that. What are the ramifications of this mistake of Ka'al? فَمَضَيْتُ حِينَ ذَكَرُوهُمَا وَنَهَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنْ كَلَامِنَا أَيُّهَا الثَّلَاثَةَ. Number one, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade the rest of the Muslims to speak to us. We were told to, fine, you're in society, wait for Allah's judgment, but the Muslims, no one else should speak to you anymore. فَاجْتَنَبْنَا النَّاسِ وَتَغَيَّرُوا لَنَا حَتَّى تَنَكَّرْتُ فِي نَفْسِ الْأَرْضَ فَمَا هِيَ الَّتِي أَعْرِفُ. The people changed. Qab radiallahu ta'ala says that the people changed around me. And he said, I began to dislike the very land that I was on, and I didn't recognize any of this anymore. So imagine, You're a sociable person. You know other people. Now, the community that you have accepted Islam with and that you are with, you are walking through the streets and you're saying Assalamu Alaikum and they're turning away from you. Imagine, just put this into context, that if you were to come to the masjid and those people that you know and everybody that you meet, they're turning away from you. You're saying Salam and they're looking the other way. They're not even responding to the Salam. This was the command of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. فَلَبِسْنَا عَلَى ذَٰلِكَ خَمْسِينَ لَيْلًا. This condition remained upon us for 50 nights. The Muslims were told to boycott us for 50 nights. فَأَمَّا صَاحِبَايَ. As for Hilal and Murara ibn Rabi', Bishara, they were so overwhelmed, they didn't even leave their house. They just stayed in the house and all they did was cry. All they did was cry. They didn't leave. He said, as for me, فَكُنْتُ أَشَبَّ الْقَوْمُ وَأَجْلِدَهُمْ. I was the youngest of them. I couldn't stay at home for 50 nights. So he said, كُنْتُ أَخْرُجُ فَأَشْهِدُ الصَّلَاةَ مَعَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَأَتُوفُ فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ وَلَا يُكَلِّمَنِي أَحَدٌ. That I used to go to the masjid, I used to go to the market. He says, by Allah, nobody would say a word to me. Nobody would respond to me. وَآتَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَأُسَلِّمَ عَلَيْهِ وَهُوَ فِي مَجْلِسِهِ بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ فَأَقُولُ فِي نَفْسِي هَلْ حَرَّكَ شَفَتَيْهِ بِرَدِّ السَّلَامِ عَلَيْهِمْ. لَا. الله أكبر. Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala, he says that I would come to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the Prophet would be in the majlis after salah, and I would say assalamu alaykum, and then I would look at the lips of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that does his lips move with wa alayka assalam or not? But no. I mean, of all the anything that not being spoken to, being ostracized by society, imagine this. Imagine that you're saying salam to the Prophet and he's not responding. Nothing could have been worse. Nothing. That this is what they had to go through. Ka'b is saying that I'm looking at his lips to see if they move, but they weren't moving. Allahu Akbar. ثُمَّ أُصَلِّ قَرِيبًا مِّنْهُ فَأُسَارِقَهُ النَّظَرُ. Then I would sit near the Prophet in salah and I would stealthily have a quick glance at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is he looking at me or not? فَإِذَا أَقْبَلْتُ عَلَى صَلَاتِي أَقْبَلَ إِلَيَّ وَإِذَا الْتَفَتَ نَحْوَهُ أَعْرَضَ عَنِّي. When I would begin my salah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would then look towards me. But the moment I would look back towards the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would turn away. حَتَّى إِذَا طَالَ عَلَيَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ جَفْوَةِ النَّاسِ. He said, this became so difficult on me. مَشَيْتُ حَتَّى تَصَوَّرْتُ جَدَارَ حَائِتِ أَبِي قَتَادَ. I went to the house of Abu Qatada and I scaled his wall. وَهُوَ إِبْنُ عَمِّي. And he was my cousin. وَأَحَبَّ النَّاسَ إِلَيَّ. And one of the closest people to me. فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ. I said salam to him, my cousin. Didn't respond, he turned away. There's a subtlety in this. The subtlety is that allegiance is to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before anybody else. Allahu Akbar. That his own cousin, closest, he says, أحب الناس إليه. He was my closest friend. But when it came to the hukum of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that don't speak to them, even my cousin refused to speak to me. When I said salam to him, he said three times I said salam to him. And three times he ignored me until I took an oath. And I sweared an oath and I said to him that I swear by Allah, do you not know I love Allah and His Messenger? He says, I took a qasam and I swore oath to him. And you know what his response was? He said, Allah wa Rasulu alam. I don't know. If you love the Messenger, because the Prophet has told us to stay away from you. Even family, no. If it comes to Allah and His Messenger, then they take precedence. It reminds me of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, that one of his sons is speaking to him, who had not accepted Islam earlier but accepted Islam later. And he says to, he's remembering the previous times, and he says to his father, "Ya Abi, in the Battle of Badr, in the midst of the combat, there was an opening for me to you. You didn't see me. And there was a clear path for me to attack you, because you were on the enemy side. But my love for you as my father, that you are my father, it prevented me from moving forward." Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala said, Do shukr of Allah, I didn't see you. Because if the tables were turned, Allah and His Messenger come first. He's saying to his dad, I didn't do anything because the instinct of you being my father, me being your son, it stopped me, it prevented me. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala said, it wouldn't have prevented me. And here, his cousin brother is demonstrating the same allegiance to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm speaking to him, I'm saying salam to him, he's not responding to me. Fabayna, then the test from Allah becomes even more severe. Fabayna ana amshi bi suq al Madina. I'm walking in one of the bazaars of Medina. Idha nabatiyyun min anbati ahli al-Sham. When a Nabatian from the people of Sham, a farmer of the Nabatian sort of tribe, from the people of Sham, mimman kadima bit ta'ami yabi'uhu bil Madina yaqul, who had come to trade his grains in Medina Munawwara, he came and said, may yadullu ala Ka'b ibn Malik, who show me who's Ka'b ibn Malik? So people indicated that this is him. So he came to me, and dafa'a ilayya kitaban min Malik Ghassan, and he gave me a letter from the king Ghassan, and the king of Sham at that time, and it was written, amma ba'd, فَإِنَّهُ قَدْ بَلَغَنِي أَنَّ صَاحِبَكَ قَدْ جَفَاكَ. It's reached me that your friend, the Prophet ﷺ, has been cruel towards you and harsh towards you. وَلَمْ يَجْعَلَكَ اللَّهُ بِدَارٍ هَوَانٍ وَلَا مُذِيعَةٍ. And Allah has not made it such that you should live in a land where you are humiliated and you are wasted. That's what's happening. You're being withered away. Nobody's talking to you. So he says, فَالْحِقْ بِنَا. Join us instead. Leave. Come to us and we will help you and we will console you. So Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala, he said, when I read this letter, I said, Ya Allah, what test is coming upon me? That now I'm being tempted to leave the Muslims? So he said, I took that letter and I threw it in an oven and I burnt it immediately. He said, after 40 days had passed, 40 nights had passed, a messenger from the Prophet's side, someone who was delivering a message, came and said, the Prophet has instructed one more restriction on you people. So Ka'b said, what's the restriction? He said, the Prophet said, separate from your wife. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Listen to the response of Ka'b. Shall I move away from her or shall I divorce her? Ajib. It's unimaginable their allegiance to the Prophet ﷺ and Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. If we were in that position, what would our response be? And this Sahabi is saying, is the Messenger ﷺ commanding me this or this? Not challenging. That, why? What does that have to do with my wife? She's my wife. I've been married for 20 years, 30 years. Ka'b says, no. What is the instruction of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's instruction was not divorce, separate. Stay away from it. One of the other companions with me, the name Hilal ibn Umayyah, his wife went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hilal's condition after this has become nothing but crying. He does nothing else. Let me at least stay and do his khidmah, his service, give him food to eat, etc. The Prophet said, fine, you have that permission, but you cannot have any... He said, he can't think of anything but this situation, Ya Rasulullah. She mentions that he's in no condition. He can't do anything else, Ya Rasulullah. All he's doing is crying. So Ka'ab mentions that some of my family members again came to me and said, why don't you go and do what Hilal's wife has done? Send your wife to the Messenger of Allah, at least let her do your khidmah. So Ka'ab radiallahu anhu said, no. That's it. It's whatever now is going to be decided will be from Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. He said on the 50th night, Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal at the Fajr morning revealed these verses unto the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven these three individuals who stayed behind. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced our tawbah, our repentance, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepting that repentance after Salatul Fajr. فَذَهَبَ النَّاسُ يُبَشِّرُونَنَا وَذَهَبَ قِبَلَ صَاحِبَيَّ مُبَشِّرُونَ. People came to greet us and give us the glad tidings that Allah has forgiven you. وَرَقِذَ إِلَيَّ رَجُلٌ فَرَسًا. Someone got on a horse to come to ride towards me. And another man was rushing towards me. He scaled the mountains. And his voice reached me before the person on the mount, on the horseback. And he gave me the glad tidings. He said, I was so overwhelmed with being forgiven that the in those days when someone came to give you good news, you would give them a reward. When Abu Talib was informed of the birth of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam by a slave girl, Abu Talib freed that slave girl on that good news. So Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala, he said that I had nothing to give except the clothes that were on my back. And I was far away from home. So he said, I removed the qamis and gave that to him as a reward. And then I borrowed a shirt from somebody else to go back to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, I came in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was happy, the Prophet ﷺ's face would shine like the luminous moon on its full night. And I saw this on the face of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ gave us the glad tidings of paradise. I said to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, I give away my wealth. I give away my wealth for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For this great ni'mah, and this is from the sunnah, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows a favor upon you, then you give sadaqah. So he says, I give my wealth. The Prophet says, no, don't give all of it. Keep a hold of something for yourself. So he sets a portion away, that portion that I attain from Khaybar, I will keep, and everything else I give for Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Ka'ab radiallahu ta'ala mentions, that towards the end of this hadith, that it's this notion of speaking the truth that saved me. So he said to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, I swear by Allah, I will never utter a false statement in my life again. And he said, from all the people whose such and whose truthfulness has saved them, nobody was saved more than I was saved by my truthful nature in front of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So many lessons inside this. I've rushed through this hadith as quickly as I could. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to understand the lessons that He wants to from this hadith, inculcate the lessons inside there ourselves. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka.